Okay, would you open up your Bibles to John chapter 17, verses 1 through 3? Or you can cheat and look on the cover of your bulletin. Today is the first of three Sundays of purpose where we're going to retool spiritually to live out our purpose as a church. If you came here since last year, 1 year ago, I was holding listening sessions with the church. And my purpose was to listen to what the church had to say as we began our ministry together. And I had three basic questions for them. What was going well at Madison Church? Where did Madison Church need to grow and develop? And where did you feel that the Lord was leading us into the future? And it was that third question that was the one that was the most important, because it allowed us to move beyond opinion, where we started actually listening to the Lord together and started a lot of conversations. What came out of those conversations was a new purpose for the church, which was to know Jesus, make him known, and plant his churches. And today we are going to look over and study the very first one of those. So if you look at the Word of God with me, as it is going to guide us in spiritual strength training today. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." This is the word of God for the people of God, and all of God's people said,
thanks be to God.
To know Jesus, make him known, and plant his churches. When this purpose was first voiced, I was with Jimmy Sturdivant. Jimmy Sturdivant is the treasurer of the church. He has been here all of his life. He remembers when the church was bricked up and when the addition was made in 1948. That's how long Jim is. He, alas, is not here today. But he was talking with me, and that just came out of our heart and spirit. And when it happened, Jimmy Sturdivant danced in his chair. I don't know if you've ever seen Jimmy Sturdivant dance in a chair, but it was quite an interesting phenomenon. And then when it came before the church council later on, and I asked them to vote on it, they didn't just raise their hands, they stood up. And I will always remember that as long as I live, as long as my memory is intact. They didn't just flop their hands up and flop them down. They took a stand, every single one of them. Jimmy was there. He was not dancing, but he was still very much in a good mood. Now, our church, like many churches, is landlocked. There is little room for expansion or near infinite expansion. So we get to a certain size and we think, wow, no more people can come in. This is a really tight spot to be in because Jesus says otherwise. So what is a little landlocked church to do? Well, we do what every faithful church does. We obey Jesus no matter what the world tells us. But to obey Jesus completely, fully, you have to start at the very beginning. You have to get to know him. You can't obey somebody that you know nothing about. Who is he? By what authority does he lead us? And what does he command us to do? And that's why to know Jesus is the first part of the purpose, and it leaps out of the scripture in our message today. In this scripture, Jesus says this odd thing. He and his disciples are having their last supper together. It was actually the first communion. And they're probably just a few hours away from the events in the Garden of Gethsemane and the rest of Jesus. And Jesus is praying before they get up from the meal. He's praying for his disciples, both his first disciples and us, his more recent ones. And Jesus says this odd thing. He says, "And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent." The Gospel of John is where this passage comes from. And the Gospel of John is famous. And if you sit down and read it, it's pretty easy reading. I mean, it's not hard. You don't need a theology degree to read the Gospel of John. But it's different, because it has all these metaphors. And the minute I say metaphor, I may have lost some people. because there's people that don't like metaphors. It talks about spiritual light and spiritual darkness. It talks about spiritual shepherds and spiritual wolves. It talks about eternal spiritual life and eternal spiritual death. And here, Jesus speaks somewhat plainly about what eternal life is. Eternal life is knowing Him. Do you want to go to heaven?
Yes.
Do you want to go to heaven?
Yes.
To go to heaven is to know Jesus. We often phrase it like this: having a deep, personal, intimate, spiritual relationship with Jesus. For Jesus, eternal life is this kind of relationship. Now, who wants abundant life? Who wants eternal life? Who wants life worth living? Just like the purpose of the church, the purpose of your life starts here with knowing Jesus. It all begins with this intimate relationship. Now, I am completely aware that I just lost probably two groups when I said that. First, I think I lost the guys because I said relationship. Second, I lost the dirty-minded people because I said intimate. Which, admittedly, those two groups may be the same, but that's another story. I lost the men in the relationship. The dirty-minded people, I lost it intimate. Public speakers are not supposed to lose their audience. Why did I use these words? There is no other pair of words for it. There just isn't. The only word that works is relationship. So guys, focus, please. Jesus can be your hunting and fishing buddy. But if He is, you're going to be hunting and fishing for people. That's what He said. They'll be much more important. That'll be much more important in the end than any kill you made out in the field. I'm not saying don't go hunting and fishing. I'm just saying, when you really know Jesus, and you're really following Jesus, you're going to be fishing for people. Everything you do and say will mean nothing and have no eternal significance unless you have this relationship with Jesus. Guys and girls. Second, why did I use the word intimate? To those who confuse intimacy with only the matters of the flesh, I say this: don't let the world dictate your understanding of intimacy. In this age, intimacy is reduced to skin and sweat. We sexualize things to the point of insanity in this culture. C.S. Lewis said this. This is a long quote, but you're all brilliant. You're all smart. You can handle it. Trust me. Ready? Here we go. He said this: if anyone says that sex in itself is bad, Christianity contradicts him at once. But of course, when people say sex is nothing to be ashamed of, they may mean the state into which the sexual instinct has now got is not to be ashamed of. If they mean that, I think they're wrong. I think it is everything to be ashamed of. There is nothing to be ashamed of in enjoying your food, for example. There would be everything to be ashamed of if half the world made food the main interest of their lives and spent their time looking at pictures of food and dribbling and smacking their lips. That's a lot of you guys. Good, 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 good. See, I told you were brilliant. All right. Now, I'm not trying to be a Puritan. Trust me. But the hypersexualization of our world is everything to be ashamed of. So don't give it any power. Don't give it any power. Look at intimacy another way. Experience intimacy another way. Now think of it like this. You don't have to explain to a soldier who has been under fire with his buddies. I've never had that experience. I've never been in the military, but I've talked to people who have had this experience. I've been their pastor. I've been with them when they were questioning the things that they did. Okay? You don't have to explain to a soldier who has been under fire with his buddies what trust and relationship and intimacy are. If you follow Jesus, you'll be under spiritual fire soon enough. You don't have to explain to evangelists what relationship and intimacy are when they share Jesus Christ with a small group of people in Tiananmen Square within earshot of a squad of the People's Liberation Army right below the picture of Chairman Mao Zedong. That is relationship. That is intimacy. Eternal life is knowing Jesus, having a deep, intimate, personal, spiritual, growing relationship with Jesus. There is nothing like it in the world. And remember that, I said that intentionally, there is nothing like it in the world. Some try to distance themselves from this relationship and intimacy by wrongly thinking that knowing Jesus means just about knowing about Jesus. That is not relationship or intimacy. That is what we called in the past book learning. You ever said book learning? Okay. Some of you are not Southern. That's okay. You're here now and we've assimilated you like the board. Okay. I am talking about the experience of relationship. I have been married to Becca now for 11 years. But suppose I walked into a bookstore and there was a book before I married her. And there was a book said, Becca the Amazing Woman. And I read all about it, okay? And it was filled with great anecdotes about her spirit, her personality, her intelligence, her patience, her infinite patience. Thank you, babe. Reading that book is interesting, but it's just book learning. Now, after 11 years of the experience of a married relationship, I can tell you that she is an amazing woman. That is personal experience. And when somebody says, I know Jesus, they're talking about the personal relationship and the personal experience. They're not talking about book learning. They're talking about the risen Jesus Christ. Now, some of us just want to escape our, you know, we want to scrape by, rather, in our relationship with Jesus and just do enough to get to heaven. Does everybody want to go to heaven?
Yeah.
Does anybody want to go to hell? Silence, crickets. Okay. Yeah. We do what we have to do just to get to heaven, just to get eternal life. And instead of living life to the full, life abundantly, life right now and into eternity, we choose this scrape by method. Now think about your best friend for a moment. This is where it ties in with the children's sermon. Yes, we do actually plan this. Do you scrape by in your relationship with your best friend? No. Otherwise, the person would not be your best friend. You go hunting together, you go fishing together, you build tents together. I don't know what the girls do, but the girls do something, guys. You do stuff together. Maybe not all of you build cabinets together. Am I the only one that builds cabinets with your friends? Okay. You share danger together. You get to know each other. Basically, you spend time together. The question becomes, how do we do this with Jesus? And it's actually very simple. You do not need a theological degree for this. You do not need special postures or procedures or things like that. You don't really even need to be especially holy, because everybody is unholy when they start the relationship or start taking the relationship seriously. That's not it, the worthy calculus. It's dumb. Don't even go there. Okay, the first thing is prayer. And again, you don't need a theology degree. You don't need to posture yourself for it. Prayer is just talking to God. What we studied last week, if you want the Holy Spirit present in your life, all you have to do is ask. There are no stipulations in the scripture about this. It doesn't say, you know, if you fill out the form and jot every I and dot every T or whatever. Dot every T, jot every I. Gosh, all right. It doesn't say that. It says, ask. Now, how would you speak to your best friend? So you start there. You ask, and you start talking as if he's your best friend. If you want more help than that, I'll be happy to talk to you. The second is study. I am totally amazed at the number of professing Christians that are repulsed by the idea of studying the Bible or going to a Sunday school class. I really think that this is a spiritual trap of the enemy. And I'm not using metaphorical language there. I'm dead serious about that. Question for you, if you have these anxieties, how else are you going to know the words of Jesus? How else are you going to know Jesus? I mean, you're just going to cook up a version of Jesus in your head and hope it sticks? We study the Word of God. You know, you probably got five Bibles in your house. Get one down and read it for 5 minutes and reflect on what he said for about 10 minutes. It may scare you to death. And one of the questions you need to reflect on is, how does my life have to change if this is true? No! Yeah. Read it to your kids. Read it to your grandkids. The world is not going to raise your kids up to be Christians. Not going to happen. You have to initiate. And honestly, the staff here can only do so much. But if you do it at home, in concert with what goes on here, in concert with the Holy Spirit, dynamic, wonderful things can happen. The author of Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says this, "For the word of God is alive and active. Even the smallest time that you spend in study, especially with your family, it will be eternally significant in ways that you absolutely cannot imagine." Seriously. I know that was like three adverbs in two sentences, but really, that's four. Third, fellowship with other Christians. I am often amazed at the number of professing Christians that the old King James phrase was forsake assembly. I don't know, I'm getting older now and I'm starting to like King James words like forsake assembly and importunity and those kind of things. I think those are cool. But anyway, I am amazed at how many Christians just forsake assembling together. I suspect it is another trap of the enemy. Let me give you some secular tropes that are absolutely true. No man is an island. No woman is an island. And another thing, no family is an island. Heaven is not a place that you can get to alone, those of you who want to go. An abundant life is something that you don't receive alone. Now, we learned this last week, the Holy Spirit dwells in the heart of every Christian. However imperfect the vessel, when you are around other Christians, you are around the Holy Spirit. The author of Hebrews also wrote this. This is 10:24-25. "And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing." I mean, they were forsaking assembly already in the first century. "As some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day," that is the day of the Lord or judgment day, "approaching." You can't do it alone. You just can't. Now, this talk is about a lot more than some commitment campaign or a church purpose. All those are very important. This is about why we are here. And the questions are simple. Do you know Jesus, or do you just know about him? Are you in a relationship with Jesus that is growing in intimacy, or are you alone? Is Jesus your priority? I'm going to tell you a story, and I tell it a lot, and you're going to hear it roughly 3 to 6 times a year. But for the sake of people who are new to the church, please act like you've never heard it before, okay? There was a young man who went to the Birmingham Zoo, and he was looking for a job. He was desperate for a job. He hadn't had a job in a long time. And he walked in, and the HR person was there and hired him immediately. You know, he said, "You've just come in time. The gorilla has died. We have no gorilla. We must have a gorilla. There is a gorilla suit. There is a gorilla mask. You are the gorilla. You have one night to practice." And so he goes home, and he takes the gorilla suit, and he practices. And the next day, he starts doing well. Very, very well. He starts swinging from the trees. He starts eating bananas, and the crowd gathers, and they love him. But the young man got carried away. He swung too hard and launched out of the cage into the next door cage, which was the lion's cage. And he comes down a plop about 5 feet from the lion. The lion looks up calmly and starts padding toward him. And at this point, the gorilla starts shouting, "Help!" But he hears a furry voice in his ear. "Oh, shut up, or we're both gonna lose our jobs." You got it. Came in two waves. Okay, I love this story. This is why I tell it a lot. Because it asks the question, what makes a gorilla? Not a very interesting question. You can see where I'm going. What makes a Christian? Is it the inside or the outside? A Christian is someone who knows Jesus, not just knows about him, who hungers and thirsts, not just for righteousness, but for Jesus himself, because they know that he has the keys to the kingdom. He has everything. Everything. So look, if you want to know Jesus, I want to invite you to publicly confess it. If you want to join this church, I want you to publicly confess that too. But if you don't know Jesus, it's time. It's not a bunch of fundamentalist wackodom. It's life. It's truth. It's relationship and intimacy in a world that says we are on our own, and intimacy in a place that says intimacy is nothing but skin and sweat. It is absolute, total cultural defiance to follow and know Jesus. And you are welcome at this altar if you'd like to give your life to Jesus. I want to invite you on the first verse of the last hymn if you would like to join the church. But take this time to commit your life to Jesus Christ.